Distress again in Jomsom. Nepal is an enchanting country, exuding nature's beauty at its best. Besides, spiritual fragrance is ever pervading in its ambience. But political upheavals that are not uncommon there render even entry into Kathmandu problematic. Situations like this arise there all of a sudden and cannot be foreseen at all. While Muktinath, Damodar Kund and Janakpuri can be visited without touching Kathmandu, the famed Pashupatinath temple and Nilakanta Narayana, as also several other places of worship in the Nepali capital, cannot surely be missed. At times, even the elements of nature prevent our holy yatra. But on this occasion, though there was no such threat, the conduct of those in charge of the travel and hospitality arrangements was so very unsatisfactory that everyone was piqued by it. I had yet another objective for my Damodar Kund trip this time. Yes, from 18th March 2009 itself, the seed was sown in me for my craving that I should visit Nepal at any cost. Such longing was further reinforced in me on 27th April 2009, the day on which the foundation was laid for something that I was desirous of accomplishing during my lifetime. What the turning was is reserved for sharing with you all at the end of this writing. It was Sri Guru Raja's ordain to me that impelled me to write so many volumes about him. Though I have been, with his blessings, writing and publishing granthas on him, based on my arduous research on the subject, it has been my long-felt desire to establish a granthalaya, to assert those strongly, so that they could be propagated in a simple and yet a forceful manner. I was always musing that the large-sized Brindavana to be installed in Sri Raghavendra Granthalaya should be adorned with a garland of 108 salagramas, and a Nepal yatra would therefore be of immense advantage to achieve that goal. But at the very start of our journey, when things went awry, a fear gripped me about what should be following from then onwards. Most of the yatrikas were irate and undecided, and de-linking our group of 19 at that stage was out of question. Some of us therefore explained to the rest that we should stand together and continue our journey, which fortunately had a softening influence on them, thus facilitating our further travel from there. At last, we left for Janakpuri, and the beautiful scenes en route made us forget all our earlier anxieties. The lodgings in Janakpuri were far from satisfactory, and food was not ready till 11 p.m. We went to bed eating what we could get at that hour. It was around 1:30 a.m. that there was a knock on our door, the person there informing that dinner was ready for us. Next morning, the place of Sita Devi's marriage and the tank where the bow broken by Rama to win the hand of Sita still exists were covered during our travel, those wonderful sights creating excitement and awe in us. Starting from there, we travelled to Kathmandu and reached the capital city at nightfall. The place had then returned to normalcy after a month. When I met the Mylapore lady that day, she indirectly expressed her helplessness, telling, "See how much blood I have vomited. Nobody seems to understand that. And if everyone should start quarrelling with me, what can I do? Is not the lodging facility here satisfactory?" I responded sympathetically, saying the number is quite large and 5 busloads of tourists have to be catered to by an insufficient number of crew members. Don't bother about us. Please allow our vehicle to proceed as we should be able to manage things ourselves. Of course, our request was complied with without any demur. The Pashupatinath temple, as also the other shrines in Kathmandu, are magnificent places to be seen and enjoyed, all of which cannot be covered in just one day. Further, it was raining now and then when we were present there. The Nilakanta Narayana, perched in water, is an eyeful sight to behold from all four sides of the tank there. Likewise, the evening darshan of the deity at Pashupatinath temple, when all the four doors of the sanctorum are thrown open, presents a unique sight of Shiva, his four faces set in different directions, presenting an awe-inspiring view. The tank in Janakpuri is a large one, while the Nilakanta Narayana tank in Kathmandu is comparatively small. We have seen earlier that when the Gopi Talab gets dried up annually, Gopi Chandana is excavated from there. But in Janakpuri, the water is reportedly drained off every year and a part of Shivadhanush broken by Sri Rama is taken out and puja performed to it. Amazing though it was to know about it and believe it, it is not known whether all the water dries itself up or is made to flow out. The divine bow is said to be expanding, and when it reaches its zenith, the Kali Yuga is supposed to end, causing destruction all around. Though such a grim scenario is thousands of years away, the legendary happening is bound to take place one day, for there are many mythological stories that uphold this belief. One such story is narrated here. I've been journeying to places visited by Sri Raghavendra during his mundane life, as also those catalogued as holy places in Sri Raghavendra Vijayam. That way, I went to Varkala once. Varkala is the sacred place of Sri Janardana Swami, which Sri Vijayendra Tirtha, the Paramaguru of Sri Raghavendra, had visited. The expansive Chakratirtha, the Janardana temple at a height, and the blue sea behind it will leave us transfixed at that glorious locale. Yes, there is a Chakratirtha at this place too. Earlier we have seen about Chakratirtha in a river and in the sea too. But here, a tank itself is the Chakratirtha. Just like the Dwarkapuri is going under the sea, the Janardana Swami temple of Varkala had also got ingurgitated by the sea once. Later, Lord Janardana came out of the water by enlightening a Pandya king in his dream. This Janardana presents the appearance of doing the Achamana with water in his right palm. That is the process of sipping water from the palm of the hand for purification. When his right palm positions itself near the mouth, the great deluge will follow and the Kali Yuga will terminate, is the belief of the devout ones. Presently, Sri Janardana Swami's right hand is near his belly. It is said that once in 12 years, the position of the hand shifts a minuscule degree upwards. Regarding Varkala and its glory, I shall be writing in detail in Sri Vijayendra Vijayam. It may not be incorrect to construe in this context that when the Shiva Dhanush at Janakpuri expands fully, the hand of Sri Janardana Swami at Varkala would have likewise gone upwards fully to his mouth from its present position near the belly. In Kathmandu, a river flows behind the Pashupatinath temple. Obsequies for the departed souls are performed on its bank. We could witness corpses being brought there and consigned to flames, even as the rendering of bhajans and chanting of mantras was going on nearby. The smoke pervading there is harmless. When exiting from the shrine, we had darshan of the 1008 lingas existent there. In the courtyard of a shrine in Janakpuri, we went inside a place veiled by a cloth screen and to our exhalation found tens of thousands of shalagramas exhibited there. They were the collections from Damodar Kun and Gandaki and yet others donated by the royalty. We visited some more shrines in Kathmandu, but all through it was the imaginary vision of Damodar Kun that was dangling before me in my mind's eye. We were in Pokhara the next day. The lodging facilities at Pokhara were on par with Kathmandu, but food was of poor quality as at other places. The following morning, My wife and relatives, forming a small group, got ready for their journey to Jomsom. Previously, the journey to Muktinath had to be performed by helicopter or on foot or donkey's back. But now, jeeps go right up to the foot of Muktinath, and from there, by taking a motorcycle ride, one can reach the top. Thereafter, climbing the steps to the shrine is only for a short stretch. Those bound for Damodar Kund were asked to be ready by 10 a.m. 7 persons from our group constituted our party to Damodar Kund, and the 8th member was the one who had travelled with us in the bus. The travel agent informed us that 4 others were joining too from among those in the other buses. It was ultimately a complement of 12 that was to journey to that holy spot. From our place of stay, before our departure, we enjoyed a panoramic view of the mountains and peaks all around. Standing tall in the misty morning, notwithstanding the chillness of that hour irking us, even in the mild sunshine that was bathing the surroundings there, the sight of the small aircrafts flying at a distance gave me the hope that my wife and others should be reaching Jomsom without any difficulty, and from there the jeeps would be taking them to Muktinath for darshan of the deity by early afternoon. We were served breakfast at 8:30 a.m. but I was at that time fully engrossed in thoughts about reaching Damodar Kund, and by 9:30 a.m. my excitement intensified. I got ready with all the protective clothing necessary to ward off the icy chillness at high altitudes, wearing some and keeping the rest for use later. The cost of a trip to Damodar Kund from Chennai is 5 times more than that of a trip to Muktinath. Although it is only for about 3 hours that we would be missing the company of the other co-travellers from Chennai bound for Muktinath. The royalty payment for entry in the Damodar Kund zone is exorbitant. If my trip to that holy place had materialized in 2004, it would have been less than half of the current cost for it. Though it has been my principle not to accept donations for my publications and the research work connected therewith, Sri M.R. Bhandarkar's munificence made me bend my stand under special circumstances. Sri M.R. Bhandarkar was trying to sell his ancestral house in Pune, and when no satisfactory deal was coming through, he happened to read the English version of my publication, Sri Raghavendra, the Saint of Mantralaya, that sowed in him the seed of the faith that Sri Raghavendra would certainly cause for him the fruition of his cherished objective. Sri Bhandarkar resolved at that time that if the sale of the property should materialize, he would send a part of the amount to me. And when it did take place, by the grace of Sri Raghavendra, he sent me a substantial amount, which I kept in a bank for my Nepal trip. The accrued interest swelling the amount earmarked for the purpose, I could easily meet the cost of the yatra later, thanks to the generosity of that good Samaritan. Indeed, strange are the ways in which Sri Guru Raja graces the fulfillment of our desires. Yes, Sri Raghavendra had answered Sri Bhandarkar's prayers unfailingly, and in the process caused the fruition of my longing too. Prompted by these thoughts, I was mentally thanking Sri Bhandarkar and paying my obeisance to Sri Guru Raghavendra when the travel agent appeared before us to escort us to the airport. Accompanied by him, we reached the airport, and in half an hour, we were in our seats in the jumbo helicopter. It was past 11:30 a.m. then, and it started getting dark in contrast to the clear sky that we had in the morning. In the helicopter, Ravi and I occupied the seats near the door, and all the 24 seats got filled before the takeoff. Soon, we were airborne. And as the flying machine started gaining height, my heart was brimming with the joy of being able to see the Damodar Kund soon. was quite fascinating to witness the scenic beauty and greenery around the mountains from altitudes much higher than the peaks in those bewitching Himalayan ranges. In those 20 minutes, the helicopter touched down at the Jomsom Airport. The group visiting Muktinath needed direction to go to the temple, and with my earlier experience of the place, I could help them, there being, unfortunately, no guide to escort them to the holy place. It was at that juncture that I noticed the helicopter pilot telling someone over his wireless equipment that there was no problem in flying up to Muktinath, and further journey from there could be decided only after knowing if the weather conditions were favorable for such flight. I became distraught on hearing such voice of pessimism, and tears welled my eyes involuntarily. I then prayed soulfully, "Guru Raja, is it your dispensation that I should be in Jomsom with a grieving heart? You gave me last time a salagrama of Damodar Kund. It's my desire now that you should cause my going there and collecting salagramas with my own hands. Having come so far, I cannot bear any disappointment this time. Guru Raghavendra," I also supplicated in my prayer, "O Guru Raja, please don't cause my writing about Damodar Kund based only on whatever I have read in the Puranas. Please grace my visiting the place and penning whatever I see there with my own eyes. Let us now delve into the Puranic stories about the holy place, as the departure of the helicopter from Jomsom will take some more time."